Elon Musk, in November 2025, in a series of X posts, made his future plans for AI compute clear. It involves launching large numbers of AI compute satellites based on the Starlink version 3 design. But, and this is the focus of this video, his vision extends to the moon, with plans for large-scale extraction of resources to build AI factories that launch satellites into orbit using electromagnetic railguns. His aim is to manufacture 100 terawatts of compute per year, which he states can only be done from the moon. 1 terawatt of power is 1,000 gigawatts, or about twice the average output of the US electricity grid. This vision, which will likely take decades to complete, requires extracting and processing billions of tons of moon soil, plus the construction of lunar infrastructure. In this video, I want to consider the second order effects, namely looking into infrastructure overspill, such as landing pads, power grids, communication and logistic networks, and the processing and extraction facilities that would be needed and could be made accessible on a commercial basis for space startups and other moon operators. Even if the project takes decades to complete, much of this infrastructure would be needed from the start. Let's look at how Elon Musk plans, using the resources and technology from SpaceX, XAI and Tesla, could bootstrap a thriving lunar economy as a side effect of his vision. Second order benefits for a lunar economy. Let's assume, for the purpose of this video, that Elon Musk executes his plans for AI factories on the moon to manufacture AI compute satellites using railguns to accelerate them into orbit. The timescale to complete this vision doesn't matter. What matters is the commitment to build lunar infrastructure to support this vision. Space startups and other moon operators would benefit greatly from this expenditure, assuming these facilities are open to other operators, which seems likely as SpaceX would want to recoup costs as much as possible. For this discussion, I assume that 1 billion satellites would be built each year to reach the 100 terawatt target. That requires about 1 billion tons of lunar materials, with a 40% yield, 2.5 billion tons of lunar regolith needs to be excavated each year. The biggest takeaway is that massive amounts of lunar oxygen would be produced. Oxygen makes up around 40 to 45% of the mass of regolith. Most metals and other useful materials are chemically bound to oxygen, which must be removed. Approximately 1 billion tons of lunar oxygen would be produced each year for commercial sale to other startups. SpaceX could use this oxygen for refueling starships, but the amount produced far exceeds what SpaceX would need. Removing oxygen can be done with molten regolith electrolysis, as demonstrated by Blue Origin's Blue Alchemist team. Oxygen, in addition to its use as an oxidizer for lunar landers, can be used for life support and other industrial uses. Flooding the lunar market with cheap oxygen reduces startup costs and helps make lunar spacecraft and landers more reusable. It can even be exported off the moon to support commercial space stations in low Earth orbit and other places. In addition to oxygen, other materials would likely be available in abundance, such as iron, aluminium, silicon-rich slag for structures and the production of glass and ceramics. All manner of habitats, rovers, communication towers and power systems could be produced. Rail networks can be laid down using 3D printed rails and sleepers from the cheaply available metals and materials. With the amount of power needed, it's likely nuclear reactors would be in operation, especially for powering a large number of electromagnetic railguns, which would have to be in operation continuously to support the launching of a billion satellites per year. With excess power available, supporting other lunar operations becomes easy. Space startups would pay a commercial rate for lunar electricity using the already established lunar power grids, which would be essential for all the machinery, refining plants and rail guns in operation. The rail guns themselves can be built with existing technology. Both the US and Japanese navies have rail guns that can accelerate mass to the 2.4 kilometers per second lunar escape velocity needed. Logistic networks consisting of lunar road and rail networks would need to be laid down to support billions of tons of lunar regolith for extraction and movement to refining centers for processing. Thousands of vehicles would be needed, such as excavators, haulers, and mining and drilling equipment. The logistics network could be accessed for a fee by all lunar startups or moon operators. This goes for all other utilities such as communications, navigation, and timing services. I've also mentioned in a previous video about thermal management as a service to provide heating and cooling services for operators. This infrastructure spillover mirrors what happens on Earth when mega projects are constructed. For instance, when oil is discovered in an area, huge infrastructure building takes place in that area to support extraction and transporting of the oil to refining facilities. This investment in a region attracts entrepreneurs, tourism, science, and potentially other export opportunities. Let's turn to the timeline for lunar infrastructure needed to support Elon Musk's vision. Aggressive lunar infrastructure timeline. An aggressive timeline, one that has billions of dollars of capital spent on lunar infrastructure, could start with prototypes in the late 2020s. In the 2030s, gigawatt-scale operations are possible with the construction of power grids and road and rail networks. Finally, in the 2040s, terawatt-scale operations churn through billions of tons of regolith to produce AI satellites accelerated to orbit using railguns. AI compute is something every major tech company is investing in. The laws of physics apply to all these companies. If they realize, as Elon Musk has, that the only way to scale is off-world, then expect massive investment in space, followed by lunar bases and factories to cut costs. AI compute in space doesn't require any water cooling, with solar in orbit 8 times more efficient and available in unlimited quantities. SpaceX has one key advantage over competitors, Starship. This vehicle will be able to land 100 tons to the surface of the moon, and with later versions, even more. This enables the landing of lunar harvesting and refining equipment. I've already covered on this channel Cislunar Industries' plans for a metal lunar foundry, so the technology for metal refining is already under development. SpaceX could partner with these startups, buy the companies, or make its own technology. SpaceX, perhaps partnering with other startups like Astrobotic, Honeybee Robotics, and Redwire, would need to lay down a power grid with vertical solar arrays to produce power. In the 2030s, it's likely one or more nuclear reactors will be operational, but many more will be needed to support the power needs for Elon Musk's moon vision. Initially, a large infrastructure program would be needed to build lunar landing pads, road networks, power grid installation, communication and navigation systems. With a power grid established, drilling, mining and extraction operations can begin. Haulers will transport regolith to processing facilities that will remove oxygen from the regolith using molten regolith electrolysis or other process. Using metal foundries, the deoxygenated regolith can be used to produce metal parts or components. Through further chemical processing, other compounds and materials needed for AI compute satellites can be produced. Later in the decade, construction of electromagnetic railguns will begin. They would need to be kilometers in length to gently accelerate the satellite to orbital speed without subjecting them to excessive acceleration. Each railgun consists of banks of capacitors that store power and can release it in a fraction of a second to provide high acceleration to payloads, easily accelerating them out of the moon's gravity well into cislunar space. Overall, a vibrant cislunar economy is possible. Once the large AI tech companies such as Google, Amazon, Meta, and OpenAI conclude that the only viable means of building AI compute at the scale needed to remain competitive is off-world, then space spending would increase to over $100 billion per year globally, dwarfing NASA spending. A gold rush for cislunar expansion. In a similar way to how SpaceX's Starlink has caused a number of other companies to build mega constellations, Elon Musk's plans for massive AI compute in orbit, followed by moon factories, could cause a new gold rush for off-world resources. Lunar lander startups such as Astrobotic, Firefly, Intuitive Machines, iSpace, and Impulse Space will benefit once companies decide to exploit lunar resources. Next would be lunar resource extraction and processing startups. Think Interloon, Magna Petra, Ethos Space Resources, and Argo Space. Large aerospace companies like Lockheed Martin have already expressed interest in electromagnetic railguns and lunar rail networks. Firefly Aerospace recently proposed a cislunar supply hub at Earth-Moon Lagrange Point 1 for warehousing of materials and supplies. Startups involved in lunar rovers and construction would see benefits. Think Intuitive Machines, Lunar Outposts and Astrolab. Sierra Space and Max Space both have plans for inflatable habitats for the moon. Blue Origin has an extensive list of technologies, with the financial firepower from Jeff Bezos to back it up. With a more powerful New Glenn coming and two lunar landers, Blue Origin is probably SpaceX's nearest rival. Spillover from massive lunar infrastructure build-out would include Cislunar activities, asteroid mining and Mars settlement. With abundant and cheap lunar resources in Cislunar space, spacecraft could be sent to Mars in large quantities, along with plenty of materials to bootstrap settlements. Launch providers will benefit first. One sector of space startups likely to benefit first will be launch companies. Think about it. Any major tech company that fails to secure launch contracts automatically loses. A critical resource for off-world computing are launch providers. If anyone has played a strategy game before, they know acquiring more resources than your competitors is a good way to win, but so is blocking your competitors from accessing those same resources. With SpaceX servicing Elon Musk's plans and New Glenn servicing Blue Origin's plans, other companies are scrambling to find credible companies that can launch, or at least have plausible plans for launching payloads at the required scale. Elon Musk plans to launch millions of satellites into orbit, which suggests competitors who want to remain competitive would have to do the same. Imagine having satellites built and ready to launch without a launch vehicle. Over time, those satellites become uncompetitive as technology progresses, resulting in the worst case in billions of dollars tied up in obsolete technology. Competitors will likely sign exclusive deals on long-term contracts to lock out competitors, even if their satellites are not ready to launch yet. This is not theoretical. Amazon's Kuiper Constellation project block-booked a large number of ULA Ariane 6 slots, blocking competitors from using those launch vehicles for years. In a winner-takes-all scenario, there is a strong incentive to lock out competitors by acquiring launch services from as many credible launch providers as possible, ensuring satellites can be launched when they are produced and blocking your competitors from doing the same. Orbital viability for AI compute is imminent, within 5 years, according to Elon Musk. With technology moving fast, the demand for launch will continue to accelerate, putting launch providers in a strong position where all their launch slots are booked quickly. Why this could benefit smaller providers? Relativity Space and Stokes Space could benefit from the need of major tech companies to gain launch access. These companies are looking to launch medium launch vehicles this year, and Stokes Space is working on a 100% reusable vehicle which could have high launch cadence. In Europe, ISA Aerospace, Rocket Factory Augsburg, PLD Space are looking to launch this year, with other companies like Orbex and Skyrover launching orbital class vehicles in the following years. InnoSpace in South Korea recently attempted and failed to launch an orbital rocket. Space One and Interstellar are Japanese space startups working towards orbital launch vehicles. These smaller providers could secure hedging slots with the more established players like SpaceX, Blue Origin, ULA, Ariane and Rocket Lab getting most of the launches. Final thoughts. Perhaps we have found the killer app for space. Orbital AI computing. Vast amounts of capital are about to flow into space operations. First building the satellites from Earth, but eventually to lower costs and increase scale, producing those satellites on the moon and launching them into orbit using railguns. Power grids are already under strain and cannot scale to meet the massive demand needed for AI compute. The only viable solution is to move this compute into orbit. Do you think orbital AI is the technology that will cause a gold rush into space? Could major tech companies be the catalyst to bootstrap a thriving lunar economy and humanity's expansion into the solar system? Leave your thoughts and opinions in the comments section below. Thanks for watching. If you enjoyed this space video, consider buying me a coffee to help fund more episodes like this. The link is in the description. Space News Live is on Saturday evening or Sunday morning, depending where you watch from. The live stream is a great way for you to share your thoughts and opinions on the videos I posted this week, or on any space topic in general. I highlight the most thought-provoking comments on videos I received, along with previews of upcoming content. If you got the time, please tune in and say hi. Be sure to like and subscribe so you'll see our upcoming videos. We make videos every week covering the space industry with an emphasis on the smaller space startups that aren't covered so well on other channels. See you soon.